What I want to do in this video is talk a little bit about money and interest rates, and do it in kind of a microeconomic framework so that we understand the relationship between the supply of money and demand for money, and the price of money, which we'll see is what interest rates actually are. And once we do that, then we'll be able to be more fluent in discussing money and interest rates and supply and demand and price of money in a macroeconomic context. So maybe the most confusing thing when you view money in a microeconomic context is what is the price? What is the price of money? And you might already be guessing, the price of money is the interest rate. And to understand that a little bit better, the best way to think about it is you're not necessarily buying money. Interest is rent on money. It is rent on money. If I said, what is the price of an apartment in my neighborhood? Someone might say it is, say, a one-bedroom apartment, and that actually is pretty close to the prices where I live here in Northern California. If you want even the most basic one-bedroom apartment, it's going to run you about $1,200 per month. $1,200 per month, which is about, what, $14,400 per year. So we should say per apartment per year. This is essentially the cost of your apartment. Now, if someone were to go, if I went to the bank and I said, hey, I want to borrow $10,000, maybe I want to buy a car or something, they would quote an interest rate. They would say, okay, you could borrow that at an interest rate of, I don't know, interest rates are pretty low right now. They'll say you could borrow that at an interest rate at 5%. And to see that this is essentially the cost of renting money, we could essentially just say that this is five, we could view this as 5 cents, 5 cents per dollar per year. So once again, when you're renting an apartment, it was $14,400 per apartment per year. Now at an interest rate of 5%, that is 5 cents per dollar per year. It's the exact same thing. This right over here is the rent on the rental price on the actual money that I'm borrowing. And once you have that in your head and you feel comfortable with that, now we can actually draw a supply and demand graph in kind of the microeconomics context, now that we know how to think about the price of money. So let's draw a little supply and demand diagram right over here. And we're going to, like we often do in our little economic models we do, we're going to super oversimplify it. We're going to not think about people, things like credit risk and the percent and the chances, the probability that people do pay back or won't pay back the money and things like liquidity and all of that. We'll just assume that everyone is going to pay back the money and they all have they're all risk-free. They're all going to do exactly what they said. And so in this axis right over here, so this is, let's call this the market for borrowing money for 1 year. And as we'll see, and you might already know, they'll have different prices for borrowing money for different lengths of time. I might charge you more to borrow money for a year than I would charge you for borrowing money for a month, because maybe I won't have access to that money, or there's a bigger risk that something might happen in that year, so I'll charge you more for it. So I have to fix the year. The market for borrowing money for 1 year. And most of these supply and demand graphs, the vertical axis, we have price. But now, as we just indicated, the price of money is really just the interest rate. So I'll call this price. So this is our, I'll do that same yellow. So this is our price axis, and it's measured as interest rate, percentage. Interest rate is how we're going to measure it. And let's say this right over here, let's say that that is 30% interest, this is 15% interest. And then this would be 10, 5, this would be 20, 25, pretty good. And then over here we would have the quantity of money. And I'll just pick some values here. Let's say we could even say that is in, billions of dollars. We could size it right based on whether we're talking about our town, our city, or whatever, or the whole world, or whatever it is. And it depends on what currency and all of that, but we're just assuming that we're in some island with one currency and all the rest. And let's say that this is 1 billion, 2 billion, 3 billion, 4 billion, and 5 billion. And so you can imagine, let's first think about the demand curve. And we could think of it as a marginal benefit curve. That those first few dollars that are out to be lent, there are someone who is going to get a huge marginal benefit of it. They want to take that, either they want to borrow it and use it for some type of consumption that they want to buy that would make them very, very, very happy, or at least they think it'll make them very happy, or they want to use it for some type of an investment where they're like, wow, if I could just borrow some money, I have this no-risk investment that's just going to, you know, make me a gazillionaire. So those first few dollars, there's huge demand, huge marginal benefit for it. And so the willingness, you could view it as the willingness to pay for those first few dollars is very high. So maybe it is way up here. People are willing to pay in excess of 30% for those first few dollars. And then as there's more and more dollars, the incremental next borrower gets a little bit less marginal benefit from it. And so you would have a declining demand curve that looks something like this. And this is just the exact same thought process as you would have if we were thinking about the market for ice cream, or if we were thinking about the market for apartments or anything else. So this is our demand curve. And when we think about the supply curve, same exact process, thought process as we would for supply of any product. So those first few dollars, the people lending the money, they're like, oh, well, there are probably people there willing to lend for very little. They have nothing else to do with that money. So another way to think of it, since they have very little to do with that money, their marginal cost of lending that money is very low. And so the supply curve might start over here. People will start to be willing to lend the money at a very low interest rate. This looks like about 1%. And then each incremental dollar, the opportunity cost for that lender is going to get higher and higher. And so the interest for that next incremental dollar is going to get higher and higher. And so we've now drawn the supply and demand graphs for the market for borrowing money for 1 year. So this is right here. This is the supply. And this is in billions of dollars, let's say billions of dollars per year. So this is how much is going to be lent in that year. And it's for borrowing money for a year. But as we see, we can view money just like we could view any other product. There's going to be an equilibrium price here and an equilibrium quantity. So the way I drew it right over here, the equilibrium price, and remember, the price of money is really just the interest rate. The equilibrium price right over here is 10%, which you could view as 10 cents per dollar per year. And the equilibrium quantity of money that gets lent and borrowed looks like about 2.7 or 2.8 billion dollars gets lent and borrowed in that year, in each year. And when we look at it this way, then we could start thinking about some macroeconomic phenomenon. What happens if all of a sudden everybody in the world, or in our little universe right over here, gets a little bit more money thrown in their pocket? So, you know, the government prints about a bunch of money, drops it from helicopters, and everyone has more money in their pockets. Well, then all of a sudden, at any given interest rate, the supply will go up. At any given interest rate, the supply will go up. So the supply curve will shift in this direction. So we might have a new supply curve that looks something like this. So we might have a new supply curve that looks something like this. And then also we could say, well, and also maybe the demand will go down. So at any given interest rate, any given price, there will be less demand. Because those people who needed to borrow money, now they have to borrow less money. And so this will shift to the left. And so the new demand curve might look like that. Now what happened? What would be our new equilibrium price? And it depends how much I shift one or the other, but the way I drew it, our equilibrium quantity doesn't change much, but it could change depending on how much the supply or the demand shifts. But what does definitely happen when that money got printed and distributed to all of these people is now all of a sudden the equilibrium interest rate has gone down. The equilibrium interest rate now, based on the way I drew it, looks like it's closer to about 6%. So the whole, and you could even think of another reality where all of a sudden money disappears from the market, or a reality where for whatever reason, because of good marketing or psychological shift in people, all of a sudden people want to save less so that there is less supply of money. Or maybe all of a sudden there's all these great investment opportunities, so now there's more demand for money. And you could think about how these curves would shift and what would happen to the interest rate, just how you would think about it for any good or service in a microeconomic context.